2 years ago, in 2017, we brought you the ultimate mid-sized off-road pickup challenge, in which we threw the then-new Chevrolet Colorado ZR2 up against the Toyota Tacoma TRD Pro. And in that competition, the Colorado eked out a very narrow victory. Now, 2 years later, we have a new challenger, the 2020 Jeep Gladiator Rubicon, which Jeep says is the ultimate mid-sized off-road pickup. So we've come here to Attica, Indiana, to the Badlands Off Road Park, to put the new Gladiator up against a new version of the Colorado, the ZR2 Bison Edition. And we're here to see if the new Gladiator can dethrone our champ. These are two trucks with a similar mission, but they go about it in different ways.
Yeah, off-road can mean lots of things.
It does. And we've gone through a lot of different tests with these things, and we've gotten a good idea of, you know, what they feel like off-road and how they perform in these various tests.
It bears noting, we're at an off-road park surrounded by a lot of customized Jeeps and other SUVs and trucks. And these are both really amazing vehicles, considering that you can just go to a dealership, buy them.
Yeah.
And take them off-road. They're so good.
They are. They both hit the mark in terms of what you want an off-road vehicle to do. None of them really struggled terribly much over any of these kinds of obstacles that we threw them at.
Yeah.
Now, one will work better than another on an obstacle, and sometimes you have to take a different line on one versus the other.
Right.
But they did get over what we threw them at every time we did it.
Yeah, and one test that we tried that we realized wasn't a test at all was just going up a normal, what we thought was a steep hill.
Yeah.
They both climbed up it in just regular four-wheel drive modes. We assumed we could probably have done it almost in rear-wheel drive mode.
Yeah,
so we said, all right, forget that test.
Yeah.
But that led us to one of the more interesting ones, which was more like desert running, though we're in the middle of the Midwest.
Mm-hmm.
But we were on pea gravel and sand.
Yeah.
Some high-speed stuff, lots of hills and bumps and stuff like that. And I thought there was a pretty marked difference between the two vehicles in the way they perform.
There definitely is a difference in the way they perform. And the biggest thing that we discovered in them putting those two vehicles down sand and at high speeds was that all of them use electronics in different ways. And getting the electronics set up in the way that makes them work the best is not easy.
It's really not. It's interesting. I was saying it used to be, you used to have to know how to like set your vehicle up mechanically. Like,
yeah.
Do you lock this? Do you lock that? Where's the center diff have to be set to go off-roading? And then electronics came along. It was like, oh, now any idiot can go off-roading.
Yeah.
No.
No, not
because
anymore.
Because now every idiot needs to know how to set the electronics instead.
I mean, I'm an idiot, and I'm still having to look up this stuff to figure out which buttons I need to push, given which condition. Like the desert,
right.
The desert running that we did earlier, the high speed
yeah.
sand, you have to put the Gladiator in what we found worked best was off-road mode plus. It's a special little button. You push that button,
yeah.
It changes things like throttle response, traction control, and then you shut off the ESC entirely. So no stability control whatsoever. That definitely helped.
No traction control and no stability by holding
right.
the button for 5 seconds.
At least that.
So
yeah.
So your wheels can just spin and paddle, and no electronic menu whatsoever. Mm-hmm. Just let the tires spin and throw as much sand as they want.
Yeah.
And that's how you keep moving. And it lets you like swing the tail around, even
yeah.
with that long wheelbase
yep.
that is this source of a lot of mockery sometimes from us.
Yeah.
Even with that, we were able to have a lot more fun with it.
It was. It was responsive. It was quick. It was, you could really modulate your fun with the right foot. The Colorado, on the other hand, felt very different. It's got a suspension that works better at high speeds over that kind of running, that kind of desert terrain.
Yeah.
More than the Gladiator. The Gladiator didn't really feel as comfortable at those high speeds as the Colorado did.
Right.
Simply because the Colorado suspension really is magic. It is astonishing what that thing can do. I won't call it a mini Raptor because Raptor does have some special qualities to it, but
right.
this Multimatic suspension in the Colorado,
right.
it really kind of saves the Colorado's bacon in a number of ways.
It does. Those Multimatic shocks, they just, They're kind of made for that type of desert running. They let you jump. The thing likes to jump. I should say the Gladiator jumps too. You just don't want to come down.
Yeah.
And I found that because I went out first in the Colorado ZR2, and I was jumping all over the place, catching some air, comes down relatively softly. Yep. And then I got in the Gladiator and bottomed out twice, and it was like, oh man.
It kind of hits with a bang.
So yeah, I mean, that suspension really absorbs that stuff great. Mm-hmm. Much better. I mean, for what it's worth, the Gladiator suspension, there's so much travel, and it's soft, and it pays great dividends in other areas that we'll get to. But out there in those berms and in the sand, it was not quite as advantageous.
No.
But there were actually some downsides, I thought, to this Colorado ZR2 out there in the sand as well. And I actually found playing with the settings helped us out there as well, too.
It did.
And one of the things I mentioned before, I said, you know, off-road can mean a lot of things. You know, off-road mode can mean a lot of things.
Yes.
And I don't think I ever really appreciated how some SUVs have, and now trucks, have multiple off-road modes like mud and ruts and sand and snow and all those things until I drove a couple of these trucks in these conditions that have one off-road mode.
Yes.
And one off-road mode doesn't cut it, because off-road can mean so many different things. And, you know, off-road on rocks is not off-road on sand.
Right.
And sometimes you want your wheel spinning and kicking sand out and keeping you moving, and other times you don't. So in this vehicle, I found, to an extent, that the off-road mode really helped keep it moving. Again, turned off Stabilitrack to keep up the progress.
Right.
But we noticed one thing, which we were just driving around in 4 high to keep it moving fast, because this was some high-speed driving. And the engine, which in this case is the Duramax diesel, which is what was available, made available to us, it just kept kind of cutting out or bogging down on us.
It died on us. I mean, we had to figure out exactly what the setting was in order to keep that thing from engaging traction control or stability control and just, boom, cutting power. But even without that, it's very difficult, I think, the 2.8 liter Duramax, to keep it on boil.
Yeah.
To keep it in the power band that you really want it to be, given the various conditions. It's not as easy. Even when we're doing some of the hill climb stuff, the rock climb, the slower speed stuff, the Gladiator, you point that thing at whatever you want to go over, and it's a combination of the Gladiator's V6 engine and its super low crawl ratio, and it just basically walks itself right over just about anything. The Colorado wasn't quite as easy to do that.
I'm going to agree with you to some extent on that, too. I really do like this diesel engine, but in that desert running scenario, even once we figured out the settings, which was one of the things we found was put it in transmission low instead of drive.
Yes.
It just started behaving a lot better and more less mysterious, you know. Stuff was happening, and just, again, traction control completely off, made it a lot more fun. But yeah, you just didn't have the throttle response that you want to make it more fun and just keep kicking sand out, hanging the tail out. But I do think there's an upside to the diesel torque, at least a theoretical one that we might have experienced in some of the slower stuff we did, like that rock crawling, which took the form of, you know, crawling over real, like sandstone ledges and some broken up concrete hills. And that is, you've got the torque to help compensate for the fact that it doesn't have the lowest crawl ratio in the world. And the competition is tough. Look at the Gladiator Rubicon, and we should keep emphasizing it's the Rubicon edition of the Gladiator that we drove, that has that super, super low crawl ratio. So having that extra torque probably really helped out.
The other thing that helped out, given that it was a Rubicon, is that it had a lot of underbody protection as well.
Absolutely.
And given the length of that thing, I mean, we were made fun of it a little bit, given the fact that it is a super long truck. It is 9 inches more wheelbase than this Colorado is.
Yes.
But it made it over things that the Colorado didn't, because its front approach angle is so dramatically better. There's no front end on the Gladiator at all. It feels like a bulldog, in that it just kind of ends right there.
You take the bad with the good in the Gladiator. There's no nose on the thing. That approach angle is amazing. I mean, there was a section of, you know, rock face that we couldn't get near with the ZR2.
We had to approach it.
We had to move way over.
Yep.
And And lo and behold, when we went to climb that thing, the nose of the Jeep went right over it.
Yep.
And we thought, all right, well, we proved one point, which is that that approach angle is superior, and the Chevy couldn't do this.
Right.
And now we're high-centered, and we got to back up. And then we're like, actually, well, maybe not.
Yeah, let's just bump it, as one of our tour guides said.
Yeah, why don't you try bumping it? You got full underbody protection. You could probably do it.
Yeah.
So, sure enough, gunned it,
and it
scraped.
Yes.
It was dramatic. Let's not play it down.
Every time that underbody hits something, I cringe.
Yeah. It's just, the bowels quiver.
Yeah.
But it made it. But, yeah, there's no question. Long wheelbase makes for a less than ideal breakover angle. But remember, it comes with that great approach angle, which the Colorado doesn't have, though it is good. I mean, we're talking about good ground clearance in both cases here.
Yep.
And since we're talking about ground clearance and stuff, that's something else that played out differently, because in the Gladiator, which is famously based on slash shares a lot with the Wrangler, has solid, live axles front and rear.
Yes.
Non-independent, is kind of a different, no pun intended, different approach than the independent suspension in the front of the Colorado.
Mm-hmm.
So the Colorado is kind of really good ground clearance in the center, but it gets a little bit lower near the wheels on the outside.
Yeah.
And we found we had to take a different line with the Colorado than we did with the Gladiator Rubicon, which...
That's expected, though.
I mean, that's not out of the ordinary for a different type of vehicle to take a different line.
Yeah.
But then we also found ourselves saying, on the other hand, we started recognizing that oftentimes it didn't matter what line we took with the Gladiator Rubicon.
Yeah.
It just seemed to be a lot more forgiving. And it had a couple other pluses going for it, at least as equipped, or as I probably should say, as disassembled.
Yes.
Because...
We took a lot of those components off because you can. It's an off-road truck without top or doors. And
that's right.
Honestly, that it may not seem like a fair fight. I mean, it doesn't take a lot of weight off of the thing because the doors themselves are aluminum and they're pretty easy to remove now. The top wasn't all that heavy either. It's a plastic style top. But when you take the top and the doors off, I mean, fair warning, I am a Jeep owner. I own a 2015, and that is the reason I bought a Jeep, is because once you take the top and doors off and you go driving anywhere, especially out here in the open air, in the wilderness, where you're getting a lot of that, bugs in the face, dust in the hair kind of thing, it is fantastic. It is magical.
I have to throw in one upside beyond the fun aspect of it, and I agree with you, and I'm not a Jeep owner, though I've always liked Wranglers myself, is that it's not just about the fun. I mean, one of the reasons that I found it more enjoyable and certainly simpler to drive in the more difficult obstacles was I could just lean out and see where the wheels were.
Yes.
I mean, it's that simple. I mean, in the Colorado ZR2, I could open a window, or had the windows open, I could stick my head out, but you can't see as well.
Yeah.
And you can't necessarily open the doors because there's rocks and trees and stuff like that.
Yep.
And then add to it other features in the vehicle we had, including they call it the trail camera.
Yeah, that front facing trail camera is magical. It's fantastic because you've not just got a view forward, you've actually got two little lines that turn as you're turning your wheels. So planting your wheels where you want them off road, whether it's a special rock that you absolutely have to hit or you're going to high center something, which is what happened to us once, was absolutely perfect. Whereas the Colorado went up the hill, got stuck, had to back down, had to find a different line. The Gladiator, you push the button on the dash, you see exactly where the wheel has to be, you put the wheel on the tire, and up and over you go.
Mm-hmm.
That more than pays for itself, I think.
It was pretty remarkable. The ability, as we said, to buy vehicles like this off the dealership floor with this much underbody protection. We bounced both of them off of the sandstone.
Yep.
Best we can tell so far, nothing broke.
Nothing's broken that we could tell.
No. Even the tailpipe on the Colorado, which is not completely protected.
No.
And
it's a big tailpipe, being a diesel.
It is. Exactly, and it sticks out.
It hasn't been squished.
I mean, you've got all the rocker guards and the skid plates, full protection. Just, we spent a whole day. We were not easy on these vehicles.
No.
I mean, amazing stuff, and a tough competition for any vehicle that claims to be able to do this stuff. But the character of these two,
yes,
definitely starts to make, like they start to distinguish themselves pretty quickly.
It does. I think either one of them is going to bring an owner a heck of a lot of satisfaction.
Yeah, I mean, and really, my big takeaway is that there was nothing that either one of them flat out couldn't do that the other could do today.
Yeah.
Maybe one would do it a little bit better, a little more effortlessly, a little bit more fun.
A different line.
Different line. Maybe one could take a jump a little bit better without pounding you quite as hard.
Yeah.
Maybe a little more fun at high speed, etc. But it was not a question of that one's stuck and that one keeps moving.
Yep.
And that, I think, is credit to both of the manufacturers.
Yes.
I think it would be pretty hard to make either of these vehicles do everything perfectly.
Yeah.
So they seem to have chosen their different paths. I'd really like to give another ZR2 a try with the gas engine and see how it performs. It's possible that, you know, we would find the less torque is a bit of a liability, or we might find that it adds enough to the desert running kind of experience.
Different throttle response.
Yeah, that was one of the things that really stood out to us. I mean, when it came to crawling over rocks and stuff like that, there was just a little too much twitchiness in the throttle of the ZR2, made it a lot more work.
I thought it was more laggy than twitchiness. I thought
it was laggy and a little twitchy. Mm. It depended on mode. I mean, throttle progression varies with the modes that you choose, but even when you choose the optimal one, it was never quite as simple, I thought, as the Gladiator Rubicon, which is, you know, too bad, but again, it still made it through.
Yeah, they both did.
And obviously, if you're buying this vehicle, it's not going to sit on a trailer and go to the off-road park.
No, these are not trailer queens.
You're going to drive them all the time, and they're both good trucks for that. I found that this was remarkably quiet, the ZR2.
Yeah.
On the highway, these aggressive tires, you hear them, for sure, but you hear them mostly when you're braking kind of aggressively, all that weight on the front. But overall, I thought the cab room was reasonably quiet. I liked the steering a little bit better. I thought the thing kept a better line.
Yeah, the Gladiator, or any Wrangler-based vehicle, quite frankly, none of them do all that well in terms of stability in a straight line on the highway.
Yeah, I found the Gladiator wandering a lot. I felt myself correcting all the time, to the point that it got a little bit fatiguing.
Yeah, heavy-duty Dana 44 axles and recirculating ball steering. I mean, it's, how many vehicles even have recirculating ball anymore? Not very many.
Yeah.
But when you've got live axles front and rear, that's kind of what you're forced to have. It is very fatiguing. And I drove it down here to Badlands Off Road Park from Ann Arbor, Michigan, in a 30 to 35 mile an hour headwind, and the thing basically turns into a sailboat at that point, because it is just blown all over the road, and it is extremely fatiguing as well. But the Colorado's not like that. The Colorado does seem to be a bit more civilized. That's, you know, partly its independent front suspension, but it's just, in general, all Wranglers, all Wrangler-based vehicles, Gladiators included, have that kind of characteristic.
I gotta say, though, I was kind of looking toward the long wheelbase, even longer than a Wrangler Unlimited, to give it a little more stability. I'm like, oh, this is going to be the upside, but no.
It didn't give it stability, but it does give it a superior ride.
Still kind of wandery. Yeah, it definitely improved the ride. I'll give you that.
The ride is much better. It is the best riding Wrangler-based vehicle they've ever created. Doesn't matter what Unlimited, two-door, four-door. This thing, because it's got that huge stretch to the wheelbase, I mean, it's 9 inches longer wheelbase than this Colorado, even, which is a crew cab midsize pickup.
Right.
So it's...
And it's, for what it's worth, this one on the highway, the ZR2, some of the same experience I had, you know, in the high-speed sand running we did today. Mm-hmm. It's, you know the bumps are there.
Yeah.
And you feel them, but they're not really hard impacts. They really damp out...
The
hardest impact, and... somehow it manages to remain relatively comfortable.
Yeah. At the end of the day, after all the dirt has flown and the tests have been done, which of these two pickup trucks comes out on top? it's really kind of hard to pick a winner among these two. It's not like it was 2 years ago when the Tacoma faced off against the Colorado. Those two pickups were very similar in their mission and what they could do very well. The Gladiator and the Colorado are two very different animals. They both do things well, but they do different things well. If you want to go really fast off-road and you like to go across the desert at higher speeds, the Colorado is probably right for you. If you're looking more towards doing rock climbing and you want to just effortlessly climb those rocks all day long, the Gladiator is probably the one that you should pick. Either way, pick either one of these things, you're really going to enjoy yourself. If you'd like to learn more about the new Gladiator or the Colorado, you can look up all the information at pickuptrucks.com.